Hello, everybody. I'm Amit Banerjee. I'm Professor of Clinical Data Science and Cardiologist at University College London. Over to Mel.
Hi, I'm Mel Heightman. I'm the clinical lead for a post-COVID service at UCLH in North Central London. And I'm working with Amy as a clinical lead for the STIMULATE-ICP study.
Thank you, Mel. And Lyth.
Hello, everyone. My name is Lyth Hismeh. I'm a patient advocate for long COVID and someone with long COVID myself. And I'm also a PPI member on the STIMULATE-ICP study.
Thank you both for joining me today. And the study that both Mel and Lyth mentioned, STIMULATE-ICP, is funded by the National Institute for Health Research. And we're doing both a characterization of current care for long COVID around centers in England, and also starting a trial, hopefully early on in 2021, looking at investigation therapies and management in terms of rehabilitation as well for people with long COVID. And as part of that study, we thought it was important to have as much discussion and information gathering and information analysis as we could. So this is the first of our attempts at doing that. In this session, we are looking at a topic that is emerging and exciting, has been widely discussed in the media, about microclots. So maybe I could go to Mel first. Mel, could you sum up as a specialist in the clinical space of long COVID, where you see microclots fitting in and kind of where we're up to?
Thanks, Amy. Yeah, so I think there's been huge interest in these publications by Pretorius's group in South Africa. And clearly there's a real hunger between amongst patients and clinicians, post-COVID clinicians, for any information about mechanisms that might be underlying long COVID. And it's been frustrating, you know, how long it's taking us to get to grips with this. And I think the interest in microclots stems naturally from what we understand about acute COVID in being a disease which very much affects the lining of blood vessels known as the endothelium. And really right from the start of clinical practice with looking after patients with long COVID, we've been interested to understand whether there were any ongoing effects on the lining of blood vessels or consequences for their illness due to a clotting pathology. And that's been quite difficult to get to hands on using sort of usual clinical approaches and usual clinical tests, diagnostics. We have seen some signals of abnormality, but it's not been a straightforward picture at all. So it was really interesting to see these two papers where Pretorius's group are describing a new methodology to look at abnormalities of fibrinogen in the blood, which they describe as microclots, activation of platelets. And they even then go on to propose some potential response to treatment with antiplatelet therapy and anticoagulation. And we thought it was really important that we discuss this further because it seems to be, like you say, a really hot topic at the moment and very relevant to what we want to do in STIMULATE-ICP.
Thank you, Mel. Lyth, I wonder if you could tell us about how the microclot hypothesis and these lines of inquiry and research are being received in the patient community, and how you personally see where we're up to.
I think from the very start, there was a theory that long COVID might be some form of vasculitis or some form of related clotting disorder. I think due to the symptoms that most patients were experiencing, and a lot of these patients were physicians or people with clinical background. And I think from the very beginning, they could relate that the symptoms seemed to tie in with blood vessel related issues as well as inflammation. Not many of us were surprised when this paper came out, I think lots of us were glad to see that, you know, some actual research has been done. And it was, I think, to say, a bit satisfying to realize that the patients were really onto something when we saw that, we saw these publications.
And may I ask, the paper that's currently in preprint about using triple therapy, so that's aspirin, clopidogrel, which are both antiplatelet drugs, so they act to stop platelets acting normally, and also apixaban, which is an anti-clotting drug known as a direct anticoagulant. So all three of those together, how's that been discussed in the patient forums or patient groups? Because that's quite a lot of anti-clotting agent there.
I think regarding apixaban and its cousin rivaroxaban, not many patients have had it as it's prescription only. And some of them have had it for either suspected or diagnosed pulmonary embolisms. They were given it by not for suspected microclots. But as for aspirin, I think lots of patients had success with aspirin earlier on in small doses, the 75 milligram dose. And well, not all, but a very large number of patients from what I can recall felt a lot better while on aspirin. I don't know if that was because of its anti-inflammatory effect or if it's because of its anticoagulation effect, but there definitely was, there was a cohort that definitely felt better on aspirin.
Yeah. Mel, how about your view on the use of triple therapy? Or this paper, which is a preprint by Resia Pretorius' group, where they're using aspirin, clopidogrel, and apixaban. What do you think we can take away from this data?
Yeah, so in my reading of this case series, I thought it was quite a big step to take to come in straight off with dual antiplatelet therapy and apixaban. I think in clinical practice, this has been something that post-COVID clinicians have found challenging, because we're clearly trying to take decisions outside of existing clinical guidance, which is always something that we're uncomfortable about. And in our own cohort at UCLH, because I think you always look back at your own clinical practice, you know, between 10 and 20% of patients have had evidence of clotting abnormalities on more usual blood tests. We have tried antiplatelet therapy in a small number, and also DOAC therapy, anticoagulation, in another. And I would say our experience is much less clear cut than what's described in this paper, where some patients have described improvements, but others not. And to our thinking, that's why it was very important to follow a stepwise approach in terms of investigating the role of these treatments through a proper randomized control study, which was one of the factors feeding into the STIMULATE-ICP proposal. So to summarize, I think it seems a bit too large a step to go straight to this triple therapy approach. And I think within this case series, we've got lots of questions about how they selected the patients for treatment, what assessment they did of patients before and after treatment in terms of documenting improvement, and also what time point were these individuals at during their long COVID illness, because we know there's a baseline change in the illness with time as well. So a really interesting paper, but are sort of raising a lot more questions than providing answers for us at the moment.
Thanks, Mel. I mean, I'm a cardiologist, so I see and treat people with heart disease, and all of these drugs are commonly used there, but actually relatively uncommonly we use triple therapy, but it requires follow-up, and you know, there's potential side effects in terms of bleeding, and I know they gave patients PPI to protect against any gastrointestinal problems, but still, that was something I would want to see more data and more experience with before we incorporate this in a pathway. Lyth, did you want to say any more on this? Or I know you had some questions that you had for us.
So at first, I'd like to question or maybe more get your opinion of what you think of the paper. That what do you think of the general idea of microclotting being the underlying basis of long COVID? Is that a valid hypothesis?
Mel, you'll start.
Yeah, I think one thing I've learnt about long COVID over the last 18 months is that there are a number of different phenotypes within the patients, and it seems very unlikely to me that one mechanism accounts for the entire range of clinical presentations that we're seeing. And that also comes from observations of what biomarkers we have been finding helpful over the last 18 months. And I've mentioned D-dimer and von Willebrand factor. So those are only abnormal in a subset of patients, and their abnormality doesn't correlate very clearly with symptom burden. There is possibly some relationship between these factors and exercise intolerance, so difficulty with exercising, which is something we're keen to investigate further. But my first thought is that that would be oversimplification to think that microclots accounts for the entire long COVID presentation. And, you know, there is other evidence evolving about other mechanisms that might well be relevant, such as the autoantibodies, for example.
Thank you, Mel. Lyth, do you want to ask any other questions?
You mentioned that there were clotting abnormalities in a certain percentage of patients. Yeah. Could it be possible that it might be a much larger percentage than what's being picked up? Because if these are microclots, then do the imaging studies we normally do with CTs and MRIs, can those detect microclots? Is the resolution sufficient? And could it be that they're there, they're not being detected, and that's why they're causing an elevated D-dimer and BWF factor and all that?
That's right. You know, I think one of the things that we lack in long COVID is much histology, where you have a biopsy of a tissue and you're able to look at the microvasculature. So we've been relying on imaging techniques. I would say that normally in medicine, what you tend to encounter with abnormalities is a spectrum of change. So you might expect that patients who had a very severe version of this abnormality, you might detect changes on MRI imaging, for example, and that's not been the case in the MRI studies that have been reported. So I think what's challenging about this work is that they are using a very new methodology, and we don't yet know how that correlates with more conventional diagnostic techniques. And I think that will be one of the really interesting questions to answer going forward. You know, in the paper, they don't correlate these presence of microclots necessarily with more available assays such as D-dimer. So if I was able to ask the research groups and questions, that would be one of them that I would raise.
Lyth, I'll ask another one, and then we might have to stop there.
Okay. So I've got a long list of questions, but I think I'm just going to go with the most pressing and urgent of them. Given the findings in the paper, are long COVID patients at more risk of thromboembolic events, pulmonary embolisms, strokes, that kind of thing? And according to how you viewed the paper, are the microclots that were found similar to the same clots that you would find in people who would normally suffer strokes or atherosclerosis or any of these things?
I don't think they are the same. And you know, where a conventional clot would be more a platelet-rich structure, and we're talking here about fibrinogen that's forming into the amyloid-type shape. It's been interesting in the over 3,000 patients we've looked after with long COVID, we have not diagnosed any strokes. And we have done MRI brain scanning on over 100 patients. In terms of pulmonary emboli, we expected to find that quite commonly, particularly from experience in acute COVID. But in fact, the incidence of pulmonary emboli has been much lower than expected in the patient group. So it doesn't seem to be correlating with conversion to sort of macro clotting, if you see what I mean, certainly from our clinical experience or from what I've seen published so far. This seems to be a slightly different phenomena that they're describing.
I'm sure a lot of patients will be relieved to hear that. Ami, if you may, just one more short one.
Sure, good.
So this was, I found this quite interesting personally from my own reading of the paper. So despite the anomalies, the plasma viscosity of those with long COVID was found to be similar to the controls, while the viscosity for those with acute COVID was found to be different. The plasma was much more viscous with acute COVID. Can you comment on that?
So I'll start us off. I haven't seen data about viscosity before, but definitely related to your previous question, the increased risk in acute COVID and in severe COVID with clotting abnormalities and pulmonary emboli and so on has been well documented. Whereas the analyses so far have shown what Mel has said, that in long COVID, that's not the case. So maybe I was less surprised by the finding that there is a higher viscosity in the acute COVID, but not in the long COVID. I don't know if you want to add to that, Mel.
No, I agree. That makes sense. I suppose one of the things about this mechanism that's being proposed is you would expect it to correlate quite closely with the severity of the initial COVID infection, where, you know, the greater the burden of endothelial injury, that the greater you might predict that they'd have a greater burden of microclots subsequently. And but of course, that doesn't match with our clinical experience, where we can see much more severe or equally severe illness in patients who were never hospitalized with COVID compared to post-hospital patients. So that's another question that I think we need to answer from these preliminary findings.
Great. Mel and Lyth, thank you so much for your time. I think we have to wrap up there, but just to say a bit more that in the STIMULATE-ICP study, there is embedded within that what's called a platform drug trial. So we are looking at certain drugs which are already available for other purposes and repurposing them to see if they work in long COVID. And those drugs that have been ethically approved or we're currently seeking approval for, I should say, are antihistamines. One of the drugs that we're talking about here, an anti-clotting drug called rivaroxaban, and also colchicine, which is an anti-inflammatory. And we're hoping to start recruitment in late January, early February. To summarize, the microclots hypothesis is definitely exciting and promising and tallies with both clinical and patient experience, but we're not yet there in terms of the evidence to suggest that we need to implement these as treatments. We need larger studies to reproduce these results, and we need to test these drugs properly, as Mel said, look at a graded approach rather than going straight in with triple therapy. We hope to see you again at our next information session. Thank you.